morning, everybody. This way we don't delay and we can enjoy lunch in the afternoon sessions. We ought to get started. Hopefully everybody can see me while I'm seating and everyone can see our illustrious panelists as well. Again, my name is Vic. I'm from a company called phoneblogger.net. I can share a little bit about what I do in a moment, but I'd like to have our panelists introduce themselves and share a little bit about their bio and their background and their company and how it relates to the world of social media. Anneke?
Sure. Good morning. My name is Anneke Jong, and I'm on the founding team, and I head up business development for my own company. It's called Bread. We do digital advertising, working with online influencers, so anyone who has a large audience online, everyone from big celebrities down to kind of mid-tier bloggers, to help them monetize their social media and their social presence. Kind of connect them with brands that are looking to do new and creative type of work on social media. So I work a lot in Facebook and in Twitter and increasingly in other platforms that I think we'll talk about today. So obviously I'm an entrepreneur myself, and we raised about $3.5 million for my company. We'll probably do a few more million this year, which is good. So happy to answer questions on that front as well.
No.
My name is Noah Fenn. I work with AOL and the Huffington Post Media Group. My primary role is on the video sales team, but I also have a cross-functional team that I work with for social, for mobile, and kind of all across the board. One of our biggest focuses at AOL is Huffington Post, which has been increasingly social platform. It's the number one shared site on Facebook for news and entertainment, which is kind of a really great place to be. And we also own many other properties that kind of fall into that social realm, that local realm, like Patch is a really good example. Prior to AOL, I spent a couple of years traveling back and forth to China, and I spent about 6 months living in China as well, so kind of building some infrastructure with them.
Mathew Thomas, I'm the CEO and founder of EventTech Labs, and we created an engagement, audience engagement and analytics platform called ConcertPass, primarily for the music industry, but now we're pitching to other verticals in sports, live events, across the board. My background really is from the music industry. The last 20 years I was an artist manager, concert promoter, agent, label owner, and also had two or three tech companies in the 90s and late 90s and on. So it sort of bridges both worlds of entertainment and music and technology for me. The reason we built this is when my artists were on tour, we never knew who actually was at the shows or our events. And sponsors were throwing a lot of money, but they never had the data and analytics behind it to increase that sponsorship dollar. So we basically built the engagement platform to identify who's at our live events and then bring advertising to that market.
Yangbo?
Yes, so I'm Yangbo. I'm currently founder of MediaWire. We're a social business strategy firm with focus on how would you make social work for you? Since much of the conversation you may hear about social these days, with the variants of this strain, you have to be on such and such network, Facebook, Twitter, LinkedIn, Pinterest, whatnot. Where's your strategy, for instance? So how to reach them? It's about making social human connection. That's what it is. It's been around since antiquity. It's only that the internet made it so far and wide. And as I will often use a qualifier, digital social, if I'm ever referring to at least social media or internet virtual presence, that bit, I often use digital social, just distinguish it from social media, which it's pretty much covers all business operations. And it's actually my fourth startup, it's my third for-profit. The last three failed fast and early, so first one non-profit, that was caught by the financial crisis. And second one was, well, we made a certain mistake about having a business plan, but no business. And third one was, And then third one was just being a bit slow to execute that. By that point, it's no longer a viable opportunity once we're at a somewhat later stage. So it's number four and closest we've ever been to generating revenue, at least on my end. So actually, we've actually got our first few clients over the next couple of weeks. These are his prospects right now.
Thank you. And finally, again, my name is Vic, and I'm the co-founder of phoneblogger.net, and we really look at ourselves as a word-of-mouth marketing tool for boutique law firms and CPA firms in particular who look at social media as an extension of their contact database so that it's a one-to-one platform for them. Can never kind of what Yangbo said, it's not necessarily a different world, but an extension of their real world to help them with their ghost blogging and social media marketing management to generate more word-of-mouth referrals back to their practices. It's a nice segue that Yangbo provided into kind of the first question I'd like for each of you to answer. Social media has been with us in a variety of forms over the past number of years. How is it effective for marketing? Is it effective for marketing? Why not? And what are your views? Can we kind of go down the line and kind of share your perspectives on how it can be?
Sure. Yeah, and I think the biggest thing to think about is authenticity, in my opinion. Especially now that social media has become so popular, there's this desire like, oh, we have to get on the Twitter, we have to get on Facebook, we must be out there. And just being there for being there's sake is not particularly effective. So I think the point that Yangbo brought up about, okay, you're there, but what's your strategy? What are you actually trying to accomplish? That is super, super important. So I think the brands and the individuals and, the organizations that really think through what am I trying to accomplish by being on one of these platforms and how do I do that authentically instead of just, like spamming people with the same message over and over again, how do we find some way to add value to the conversation, create content that people are interested in or that benefits, their day-to-day lives. So I think that's sort of like where the evolution has come in my opinion.
Sure. I would actually agree very much so with that. I think it comes down to the conversation, it comes down to the content, and it comes down to authenticity. I think, very often there are marketers that think, oh, well, this message is important to me, so therefore the audience out there is going to think it's fantastic and they're going to want to share it. But it really comes down to becoming part of the conversation. One of the things that, we do at AOL is try to jump into the conversation in kind of a trending topic way. So if there is something, how do you attach yourself? How do our advertisers attach themselves to that trending topic and become associated with that trending topic? Hopefully it's a good trending topic. But a really interesting example right now, which is a pretty wild example, maybe not even a brand safe example, is you look at Mad Men, right? John Hamm, is it? And people are talking about John Hamm and a part of his body that people shouldn't be talking about. And meanwhile, underwear brands are going bonkers over this thing. They're trying to integrate their social media and all of their media surrounding something like this. And again, it seems like it's a silly and stupid thing. But the point is it's content, it's conversation, it's a topic that people are organically talking about. It. And how do you attach yourself to the content conversations that are happening out there?
I tend to agree with both of what you're saying. I'm looking also from the perspective of we work with a lot of ad agencies, and the brands themselves really don't understand what they want. So when they come in and say, hey, I just want as many likes on Facebook for this particular event or thing they're doing, they're missing the whole point. It's now a re-education process. And like, look, it's not about likes. It's not about any of the typical things you're thinking that you did with digital or display ads. It's thinking about what you used to do on TV and radio. It's about the branding part, the engagement part. How do you can increase that conversation for a long amount of time, getting back to the authenticity. And the issue is always that battle, because some of these big brands have so many people that are part of that chain that you have to either convince or understand, and most of them still don't use any of the social media technologies. So when you're looking at this conversation, it's really what we're providing is we have to direct them, saying this is what we're going to do. And you're going to like it, and you'll see the impressions in one way or another coming back down your bottom line. So it's really making both for the brand and the consumer the authenticity, and then actually extending it for the overall campaign what they're planning to do in the future.
Yeah, but what have you found that's been effective and not necessarily that effective for you as well as for the clients and participants?
Me?
So really what I feel is, first, social media and social media marketing, they're really not the same. Just keep that in mind. If you have a social media strategy, it's not the same as a social media marketing strategy. And just one example would be some case study in Top Business Review back in October, in November 2011, Qantas. So the backstory was back in last summer and that fall, there were a few labor disputes. The CEO tried to end it by doing a lockout. And that caused the government to intervene. They had to go under arbitration, demanded to give the plane one day, some kind of agreement, no agreement. And the day after, what happened was the marketing team sent out a contest. So tweet us your dream and fly experience. And we'll give you some first-hand spot. Use hashtag Qantas Luxury. And then in the first 30 minutes, they were deluged with hundreds of tweets from frustrated customers on lines of Qantas Luxury is having CEO give himself 50%, yet thinks 3% for employees is being greedy. And what it really entails is you can't really just stick social media to marketing. That's how you get burned as a brand. It's about your entire organization as a whole, that people can talk back at you, that you can't simply, because they just throw out there and just imagine imagine that way and hope no one notices or that it sticks somewhere, people can and they will talk back at you. And that's the key about social, how it's different from traditional marketing.
I think this might be useful for you guys just to touch on some of the topics that were brought up. This first one about, you know, how do you as a brand find a way to kind of attach yourself to the topics that are trending, like the conversations that are already happening? A really, really good example is what Oreo did during the Super Bowl. So I don't know how many of you are familiar with this, but they actually had like a team that was just dedicated to watching the Super Bowl, seeing what was going on, monitoring social media, seeing what the trends were, and trying to find a creative way for them to kind of, you know, get in there and grab that wave. So when the blackout happened during the Super Bowl, and of course this is like the big topic that everyone's talking about on Twitter, and there's all these kind of like jokes going around, they came out with this great little ad that was, you know, mostly dark, and then there's a little Oreo, and it says like, you can still dunk in the dark, or something like that. Super quick, they were able to turn it around, get it out there, and of course this tweet and this Facebook post like blew up, because it was like a very authentic way for them to be able to integrate themselves into a conversation that was already happening. And that was way more effective than if they'd just been sitting there saying, buy Oreos, buy Oreos, buy Oreos. Like, nobody wants to do that. Like, that's not going to be effective. The second example I wanted to give was, you know, this, like, you know, where you're looking for ways to bring somebody value, like, how, you know, when you're going to have someone having a conversation with you. So I have an example of a friend who was going to go to a concert, and the concert was sponsored by an apparel brand. They have jackets and outerwear. And she tweeted something like, oh, I'm excited to go to this concert tonight, but brr, it looks like it's gonna be cold. You know, it's like an open air coliseum. And this brand replied just to her and said, hey, you know, we hear that you're going to this concert and you're gonna be cold. Can we send you like a complimentary jacket? So they give this girl a jacket, like she goes and she like picks up this jacket that she has and has like a great experience with this, right? Like she gets this free jacket, like she had this wonderful interaction with the brand, and anyone who will sit still for 10 minutes, she will tell this story, and she will tell you the name of the brand. And that one person, you know, they didn't, it's not like they blasted it out to their millions and millions of followers. They contacted one person, gave her an incredible and authentic experience, and now she is just like a true ambassador and evangelist for the brand. And that's like kind of where, you know, what you're getting to about, it's not just about the number of followers, it's about the authenticity and the strength of like those individual conversations.
And we work predominantly with a lot of small companies, very local companies, boutique practices, and to really take Anneke's point, Matthew's point, and even the others, to kind of bring it home, we can all mimic that. First of all, it's not just about quantity. It's not that you don't know or don't have millions of Twitter followers or thousands of Facebook likes, etc. That A, it's okay to have a few, and B, it's much more about conversion, about each one of them introducing you to another one person. We have a very simple slogan, a very simple goal when we work with our firms, which they work on a lot of retainers. So for them, if we look at, can every one of their clients bring them one more client? And can we replicate that over and over? And if they have now 20 retainers, become 40, become 80, 160, and thus the penny a day phenomenon becomes a wonderful amount of business. And the very simplistic perspective of looking at, can every one of your followers introduce you to one more? And essentially, is it doubling the quantity, but more importantly, converting it into specifics? To take like Anneke's example of what that apparel company did with that one person, they obviously saw that one person was obviously a center of influence and a VIP when it came to social media. Well, every one of us knows maybe one or two, a handful, maybe a dozen at most, of what we call group leaders. They may have a very strong following online, or they may have a very strong following offline that is essentially an email list. But that email list is going to be converted to Facebook and Twitter and LinkedIn, etc. So every one of you right now knows maybe two or three people who kind of bring people together in a formal bureaucratic sense as a group, or just naturally because they're just really social and gregarious. And focus on those folks to be your evangelists, your raving fans, to kind of bring clout back to your world. And incidentally, you can check out clout.com to even find the other ones that are more social media oriented. Specifically, kind of, we have a variety of topics to cover. From a local perspective, what do you think is happening for a small company, maybe startups that are more geographically based, and how can they utilize some of these social media platforms, or even what you do at a company? Anyone want to talk about that?
Sure. At AOL, we have something called Patch, and I'm not here just pitches as an evangelist for AOL, but Patch happens to be a really great example. For those of you who don't know what Patch is, it's a local community. Basically, it's almost like your community paper, right? It takes into account all of the local events that are happening. It takes into account what's happening in the news in the general area, if there's anything going on in stores, if, you know, Timmy fell off his bike and so helped him. It's sort of just that local social paper. And something that's really important with that is that it brings the idea of social back down to just community. So it's not about being able to, you know, one of the benefits of social media is being able to network and connect with people all across the globe. But in this case, it's networking and connecting with people just in your community. So for those smaller businesses that, let's say, only have a radius of, you know, 2, 3, 4, 5 miles from their store, like a local coffee shop or something like that, the circle of influence and the people you want to influence are in a local area. So, you know, Patch plays an important role in that, but also there are other technologies like geofencing, which play an important role. Is, you know, we have information about particular users. These particular users happen to be walking close enough to the store. Let's give them an offer. We know they like coffee. Here, there's a special on coffee. And sort of personalizing messaging to people who are in the geographic area, as opposed to blasting the messaging out to people who, you know, quite frankly, the message isn't relevant because of proximity.
I was actually going to say a story. One of my friends owns a venue, music venue in LA called Roxy, and it's about a 500 capacity club. Another friend runs marketing for Madison Square Garden. So about 2 years ago, Madison Square Garden started getting into the social media. We didn't know like anything. Like, oh, we have the Facebook, Twitter. Like, we want some followers. So they did this big event where they're doing a bar crawl with all their venues in New York for a select group of people trying to get more Twitter followers. So at the end of the day, they were going, oh, we have 900 Twitter followers. So we started talking to a friend of mine, a friend in LA, the 500-seat venue. He's got 155,000 Twitter followers. And started looking at why, how did he get this? You know, Madison Square Garden is a huge, massive, well-known brand. And the Roxy's well-known in its community, but not worldwide. And then he was telling me about how it's the authenticity of that. He just didn't push the Roxy as a club. He started speaking to things and interests that he had and his other people on his staff had. For example, he's vegan. So he'd get into the vegan, you know, forums and talk about his food and lifestyle. And naturally, people would start asking him, so what do you do? I was like, oh, I run this club, the Roxy. And then they started talking about, all right, well, you know, if you stop by, I'll, you know, let you in for free or come to see some concerts. And it built this whole kind of massive campaign around what the venue was, how it's tied to the local community, how the artists are starting to break from that level, whereas Madison Square Garden to this day still has complete problems on their social media. Well, I shouldn't say that out loud because of friends, but they're still having a lot of problems on how to market and use social media effectively because it is a larger audience and how do you effectively get one-to-one. Because everything we're doing now, when we're talking about social media marketing, digital, it's changed from the old days of advertising where it's just in your face and you can't respond. Everything's changing on a dime. It's everything's responsive. You now have a voice to complain or to be positive about a particular brand. And that's really, I think, what's changing this industry because agencies are now finally figuring that they're picking up on that and saying, all right, we can't just push a message out there. You have to be really responsive back to what the clients want, not only what the clients want, but what the consumer wants as well.
Yeah, I think the idea of local, when you're thinking about social media, there's really two purposes for social. I think one is to go out there and potentially do marketing, like recruit new people. But some part of it is actually like creating a home and a tighter community for the fans and customers you already have. And I think particularly for the local businesses that I engage with on social media, that's 100% what it is. So there's a coffee shop that I go to all the time that's down in Greenwich Village, and like I follow them on Twitter, and I check in there on Foursquare all the time, and I follow them on Instagram. The coffee shop is called Fair Folks and a Goat. And the other day I posted something about, like, I was at the zoo with my little sister and I posted a photo of us with a goat. And they liked the photo and commented on it. And that little moment, like, that doesn't take a lot for them, but that really makes me feel connected to the brand. And that's, again, local, it's like down the street from my house. So it, you know, really to help to build those relationships the way you would build them, you know, as person to person, can be, you know, business to person or brand to person if you take the time to do those little micro interactions.
I think, Vikram, actually, you made a really good point earlier. It's not the quantity of the likes, it's the conversion of the likes. So it's building that connection with the users. So even if you have 20 users and they're all constantly coming back to your coffee shop, not just for the morning coffee, but for the lunch coffee and for the dinner tea or something like that, that's much more valuable than having 5,000 likes, and of which, you know, 10 are valuable. So again, it's that quality factor.
Yes, and I would just add in short on that, just keep in mind that likes, followers, such, you may have heard the term Mathew metrics before. So precisely those are what they're called, so that they may look impressive on the surface, but the question you should ask is, what are they really doing in terms of objectives? So to have likes and followers, and not to mention that there are many who inflate the figures by buying likes, buying followers, just like how 10 years ago that many were actually buying links through and trying to increase their standing on SEO. So the issue is, think about this way, just figure out who your core audience is, who's going after them. Keep this in mind, just the only thing you can keep in mind is the mass market, and we'll work with this as well. The mass market is that there's not that huge mass market, but literally you could say thousands of different niche markets. Figure out who your 1% is. 99% of people out there, they won't care about what you say or do or you provide them. Find out who your 1% is.
Well, that becomes a nice segue into even not only the next question that we have prepared, but something that I want to even have as a spin-off, talking about verticals and talking about increasing the community. How many of us are socially, as consumers, active on Facebook? Good number? Not as many as I would imagine. I want to walk the panel to opine on kind of Facebook's latest revenue model of sponsored posts. And while that's not strictly social media, it's much more a little bit of an advertising model, it's kind of the segue between advertising and strict social media. What do you believe about sponsored posts, let's say specifically on the Facebook platform? Is that positive, negative, or let's say a company to engage in? Any opinions?
Well, I can
have more sponsored posts on any platform.
I can really get a sponsored post. A good example would be Twitter. So, you know, I have my Twitter account. I'm constantly going through the feed, and I get gotten, or whatever the word is for that, by these, you know, promoted posts all the time. It's because it's relevant, because they're actually speaking to me, and I'm like, oh, that sounds really cool. Is this from TechCrunch? Oh, I got hit again. And I do think, you know, I'm on the advertising side, that is a brilliant way to reach your followers. But again, the key was that it was so relevant, and they were actually going after my niche, which is advertising, technology, business, right? It wasn't talking about anything else, just advertising, technology, business, and that's me, right? So I think if you can run a sponsored post and it's relevant to that audience, and you can, I don't want to say trick, it's the wrong word, but sort of become, blend in as part of the content on the page, and there is a true value of this thing. It wasn't saying, you know, buy this, download this app right now. It was saying, you know, hey, by the way, this is what we're doing. We're working in your space. Oh, that's cool. Let me check that out.
Yeah, I mean, I agree. I think the early indications on how Twitter and Facebook sponsored in-feed posts and content are doing look good. Granted, it's still in the early days, so it's new, right? So anytime there's like a new ad unit or a new way for a brand to engage, like it does really well early, and then people can kind of burn out on it. So we'll see. I have to agree. I think like as long as it's relevant for the audience, you can perform really well. Generally, I think this is very much the space that I work in my day job. It's very, very hard to scale that sort of thing, especially if you are, you know, in the case of Facebook or Twitter, maybe it's a little bit easier to scale because they have access to those networks, but a sponsored post where you're, let's say you're getting a blogger to write a post on your behalf, like that kind of thing is a lot of work. It can work, you know, it can generate, you know, good leads for you potentially, but it can be a little bit harder to scale, so just thinking about, you know, how you want to spend your money.
Actually, the Huffington Post, we have something on the front page. It's called a sponsor post, and there's two different types. One is a slideshow where, you know, just on a topic of interest, and then the brand can be aligned to it. And another is an actual article on, let's say, a current issue. So an example of one of my clients, it's a company called SugarSync. It's sort of like Dropbox. They wanted to get involved in that tech conversation of, you know, how are things changing and what's going on with the hype. And so they created a sponsor post, front page of the Huffington Post for a day and a couple of days on the tech vertical. And the conversation was, is cloud computing in that same hype cycle as Facebook? Like, what's going on in that industry? And their CEO wrote this post and put it out there. It was very, very well received. But the one thing to keep in mind is, you know, you're paying for audience, and it was very, very expensive as well. So, you know, figures we're talking about over $40,000 for one day on the front page, reaching, obviously, millions of users. And then there were a couple of other days and a couple of other added values to it. But it's, you know, it's not necessarily an effective conversion strategy of, I'm going to spend $40,000 and I want 40,000 new users.
Back to a very simple approach to a sponsored post or promoted post. And sorry, I don't know if we actually literally defined it, but I think you kind of get the concept that you're paying, obviously, to have that post highlighted to a specific demographic, which can obviously, as Anneke and Noah mentioned, can be extremely powerful if done right and done not as a sales pitch, but as value. valuable content. Very similarly, there's no reason why you couldn't mimic the same process. It's very similar as kind of old school, one of your friends or colleagues who's an influencer to essentially take your content and then cross-promote it to their network, either on their Facebook page and or through their email list. Just, and while you either may provide an incentive for that or you're doing a reciprocal favor, it's an opportunity for you to literally mimic that same process in your local community with the VIPs that you know already. So you don't really have to think too far and wide of how to really access different demographics, especially if you know related businesses to yours, where naturally you share a very common audience and common potential consumers. Well, for you to cross-promote and cross-market is a very simple way of mimicking the process of promotion of a promoted post, but doing so, A, without the cost, B, very localized, C, almost having an endorsement on behalf of that VIP center of influence, so something to consider. I want to bring it back to our panel and have a two-part question. First, we all know kind of the big three, the mamas of social networking, Facebook, Twitter, LinkedIn. Kind of two-part question. One, what do you see as kind of up-and-coming social media platforms that are really taking off and powerful? Are they accessible specific for a specific demographic or vertical? And then B, what's your favorite social media platform? And Yangbo seems to be like tweeting constantly. Well, panel, I'm going to start with you.
Yeah.
What's your favorite platform? And what are the new apps or platforms out there for social networking?
Well, so this is just a summary of our current presence. And given that some of you, the others, just spoke about Facebook, for us, we don't even bother with Facebook. That's not where our audience is, so we're completely off, literally.
And where is your audience, and why don't you speak?
So, right, so typically what we find is, typically where our audience is, it would be, we use, so LinkedIn, Twitter, those are big ones. Tumblr, we're getting up to speed there. And then also, to an extent, Pinterest, which I feel is more of an encyclopedia, whereas Twitter, then that would be more of your daily paper, at least in terms of if you need a hard object for a frame reference. That's how I view them. And at least for right now, what I could see going forward is you might, don't be surprised if you could see a few more of these specialized, so one area would be specialized social networks, so social networks for various types of people, for instance, or another area where it's going would be enterprise social, which has witnessed Box.com. They're gearing up for an IPO in a few months, and they're actually pretty aggressively valued if you look at some of the figures there. Enterprise social, Salesforce with Chatter, Microsoft with Yammer, and Skype, which they're using to replace MSN, their messenger service. And
do you have any opinion on what Salesforce is doing with Chatter?
Well, I would say it's current with Chatter.
Go on.
Yeah. Chatter, they are literally using Chatter as the centerpiece of their branding right now. So how do you make, at least their motto is business is social. That's basically those in three words. That's their brand statement, business social.
We use it, by the way.
Yeah.
That's how we communicate on every project.
Can you explain, so, because again, we're kind of going over things that we don't define it. So what is Chatter versus Salesforce, and how do you use it?
Sure. So Salesforce serves as two things. It serves as a database of ongoing projects. It also serves as a repository or a CRM of our contacts, so that everyone in the company can stay in contact because there's multiple people working on the same project. Chatter for us, and it's been a recent migration. It used to be only on email back and forth. Chatter is a way to organize all those people around projects. So if a project gets initiated, let's say, you know, an advertising project, in my particular case for video, an RFP, a request for a proposal comes in from a client, it gets inserted into our database and automatically shoots over to Chatter, moves across to all the teams that are involved in it. So everyone says, okay, something just came in, it's on my radar. And then people start to respond to that, and it's constantly on your radar. So it's almost like a Twitter feed where at the end, at key points in the day, I just look back and say, all right, what's going on with this? What's going on with that? Okay, good, 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 got it. Instead of having, 55 different emails, and some emails someone left me off, and some emails I was added on and I didn't need to be on it, it's just at one place. So we also use it as a form of internal promotion. So if somebody does a great job, big sale, chatter it out to the entire group. And we've set it up so that there are different chatter groups. So there's an AOL sales group, and there's a movie phone group, and a TechCrunch group, and all these different things. So if there are relevant things to just a particular category, those would go out as well. So it's kind of become our Twitter, but also our project management software.
Mathew, Anneke, your favorite social networking platforms, and what do you see upcoming as either a platform or phone app?
So for what I do, I really love LinkedIn. Like, just because it's always been, without LinkedIn, that was my personal life. Like, I was always one of those guys that introduced people, hey, you should meet so-and-so, they're doing what you do. LinkedIn has just made it a lot easier to take those contacts that I'll forget. I still have boxes of cards of people I meet all the time. And just sifting through that has always been very difficult. But with LinkedIn, you can get within 1 or 2 degrees to pretty much anybody you want to meet out there. And within a contact, and people are pretty good about introducing each other for business, work, social, whatever the case may be. What I'm starting to see a lot of social networks is Pinterest, which I still really don't use it. My niece and nephews and all that use it constantly. But what I'm starting to see is as Facebook had a whole ecosystem of ad companies and different brands started working around it, and these tech companies would actually build interfaces to help advertisers engage within Facebook. I think that's the next wave. You're going to see that with Pinterest, where they're still trying to figure out whether it's a consumer brand or a fashion brand, trying to understand how to actually be authentic on Pinterest. You're going to start seeing companies evolve around that to try to help work out that engagement between the two. I think that's the next big platform that you're already seeing companies getting funded in that space to do things like that. So.
I'm going to disagree. I think if you'd asked me a year ago, I would have pounded the table for Pinterest, but I think they kind of had like a really fast peak, and it's sort of been unclear where they're going from there. You asked a two-part question, like, what do you think you need to keep your eye on, and what's my favorite? I have one answer for both of those, and it's Instagram. Instagram, Instagram, Instagram. I am so bullish on this platform.
App, platform,
everything,
you use,
everything.
You
I think, and so some of it is because it's so, so simple. It's super paired down. I don't know if you guys are using it, but it's literally just one simple photo stream, and it's mostly just photos, and that's all you're seeing. So in the evolution where we go from, you know, heavy text online, you think about blogs, and then we're down to Facebook posts, and then we're down to 140 characters on tweets, like now there's just like no words, it's just pictures, right? And the rise of Pinterest and Instagram and Tumblr to some extent really emphasizes that we're moving towards photos. In my opinion, like if a tweet only has 140 characters, like a picture is worth 1,000 tweets, right? Like you can do so much more with an image. And frankly, right now, I think Instagram has a lockup on that, particularly for the younger generations. I remember when I first joined Instagram, and it was kind of all just like artsy photography people. Their popular page was just like gorgeous, like really good looking photography. Then, like, the floodgates of teenagers came onto that platform, and they changed it from the popular page to the explore page. And now, it's just like, if you want to go and, like, waste some time, go down the rabbit hole of the explore page on Instagram, and you will be exposed to a whole new world of a different demographic. And this is the demographic that's coming up now. Like, this is the future of online and digital media is all happening right there. And there's so much crazy stuff. Like, just one example. There's a bunch of them that do it, but this one girl in particular who makes Instagram comics. So I don't know if you guys use Instagram, but there's a bunch of different apps out there that will let you do multi-panel photos, right? Where there's like 3 or 4 photos like in one photo. And she'll do those, but then like write on them and make like a little comic. And they're not really that funny, but she has millions of followers, they're super engaged, and kind of to your point about doing these like cross promotions, like, well, we work together, you let your followers know, I'll let my followers know. She does these little like collaborations with other Instagram comic makers, where they'll do them together, and then in the comments be like, hey, I'm doing this, you know, this collabo with my friend Vic, like, be sure to follow him too. And it's so savvy. And they're like 15. Like, there's not a brand behind them, like, telling them what to do.
And inevitably there will be.
It's totally authentic.
Do you see any companies effectively using Instagram?
Yeah, no, I think there's a lot that are using Instagram really well. And the tough thing is because it's such like a simple and pared down platform, there aren't a lot of bells and whistles that are useful for brands. So, it's a very small company, whatever it is, there's 7 people on Instagram, they just got absorbed into Facebook, they're still trying to figure out what their model is going to be. But I think the savvy brands are getting on there now so that they become super familiar with it, they're like digital natives to the Instagram world, such that when they do start rolling out features that may benefit brands reaching out to people, you're like ready to hit the ground running.
Before I open it up to questions in the remaining time, so you can kind of think about questions that you have for the panelists, I want to kind of bring up one point that none of you actually mentioned in terms of kind of the rising star of social media. You kind of talked about the early peak of Pinterest and kind of what are they doing now. none of you, outside of prior example, mentioned kind of the relevancy of Foursquare or Facebook Places, Google Places, location-based social media, location-based networking apps. Kind of, we don't want to make eye contact with each other on the streets of New York, but will we network with those who are around us? Is that passé suddenly already?
So I love Foursquare. I'm like a slavish devotee to Foursquare. I check in everywhere. I'm mayor of like everywhere. I leave tips. Like, I love that platform. I also realize that I am like a rarer breed these days. I think what Foursquare built is like one of the most valuable digital databases in the world today. And that's like a live and active database of all the world's places. So valuable. But you don't keep the relevancy of that database without a huge user base that's like, you know, in Wikipedia style, like constantly keeping it up to date. And for whatever reason, you know, like the excitement related to local check-ins and that sort of thing has sort of petered out. So, I mean, I would love for that to be something that we can rely on. You know, when you ask your question about local and how do the local businesses really capitalize on social media, you know, a year or two ago, my answer would have been, yeah, let's do this Foursquare thing. I just don't know that there's enough interest from people to do it. And it may be just like that the Foursquare ends up being the friendster of that space, and we just weren't collectively ready for that. And so maybe somebody else will come down along the line where there's less friction. You know, it doesn't require you to actually open up an app and search for the thing and do it, that, you know, maybe it'll be a little more passive. I don't know that we as a society are like culturally comfortable with like the trust levels necessary to allow things to just track your location passively. So it may just be a little while before we capitalize on.
So I actually like what you said, because my entire company is based on location. So it's all mobile play. We were the first company to use NFC at concerts, we use QR codes.
NFC being?
Near field communication, RFID. So we still use that, we still build it to all the apps. We're partners with Samsung and a bunch of other companies. Our new app, our new platform is launching with QR codes and ultrasonic sound. So we are doing a lot of those kind of pieces. And I think where Foursquare is going and sort of is taking a turn and it's not really monetizing revenue is because it wasn't sure how to, initially it wasn't built to monetize. It was built to be an application based off of another application. When we came in, we saw there's a particular audience we have an expertise in, entertainment, music. We have an ability to capture a very large audience quickly so that, you know, our part is let's reward the customer, let's reward the fan for being a fan. How do we engage them on a constant basis? So it's not just about the check-in. The check-in is just an alternate way of means to an end or tool to get compiling data. We're really looking at how do we create the band, brand, fan extension that, you know, this is part of their life. It's a certain age range, 18 to 40, that are so active and so into that music space, into the bands, the activities they're doing, that when we actually worked with a band called OAR, which most people either do or don't know, we did their full summer tour. We worked with a couple of brands on that and had their VIP experiences as part of the program. We had a 98% conversion rate right off the bat. And by the time the event actually happened, we had 100%. Everybody actually went to use the system or to go to the concert used the system. And when we asked them, why did you use it? Why did you give us all this data? Oh, the band told me to. That was as simple as an answer. And it clicked to us going, all right, if any artist tells you to do something, this is such an untapped market. You know, if Justin Bieber says something to about a brand or anybody, their fans go nuts. You know, and there's a good way and a negative way to control that market. And as long as the authenticity is there, that you're being relevant to what the needs of your customer base and identifying, all right, who are these people? They're all individuals. How do they relate together? I think there's a way of using location. You know, just beyond the old SMB, let me try to throw ads at you. Let's give something back to them and they'll actually be more responsive. We're seeing a very big uptake on that. So.
Yeah, I mean, Anneke mentioned an important point, which is the privacy issue. I think that is something that's holding back, and for good reason. Obviously, what is happening to the data? What happens if this company gets sold? For instance, there's actually a great example. My data got transferred with whatever acquisition it was, and I'm like, man, now someone knows that, you know, my favorite movie is Terminator 2. Oh my God, yeah.
Like,
it's pretty embarrassing. Of course, you know, I filled that out during Friendster days, but the point is you know, there is that idea of data, of privacy, and there's a beauty that comes with opening it all up and allowing local coffee shops to know what your favorite coffee is and catch you while you're walking by, and there's also a fear of, oh man, what else are they going to know? They're going to know that I pass their store every single day at, you know, 8:26, and you know, they're going to know when I went from here to there. Oh my God. So there's that issue.
But on the flip side, on a positive sense, is Patch doing anything since they are very hyper-local, kind of that is their mission? mission, if you will. Are they encouraging anything in terms of location-based networking through any kind of Foursquare-type platform?
They're not there yet. No, okay. No, they're not. I think some of the things that they are doing, and maybe it's more to promote their own brand, but they are looking at, you know, when something that could be viral happens in a community, and a good example is there was a the guys at the ski mountains that help people get on and off the ski gondola, and this guy in some random patch town decided he was gonna turn on rap music and just dance the entire day in a t-shirt, and he just did it. And for some reason, you know, patch picked it up as a story, as a video story, and it just went viral. It went all over the web. It got picked up on YouTube. It got picked up every single place. So it could be used as a vehicle like that. But from the standpoint of checking in, I think that is something where when there's active participation, people might forget, and then because they forgot, now they're not the mayor anymore of this place, they get frustrated. I think there is a small gap that's going on right now.
A restaurant once gave me an incentive, $5 off a margarita, I think the Mexican radio, for checking in, and that was, I asked my wife's permission if I could then grab my phone and check in and get some discount on a margarita. That was really the only time I ever checked in to a retail location. However, you know, I thought maybe it would actually take off, and but I can see some privacy concerns. Now, the irony of social media, talking about social media is one thing. The whole purpose of social media, as we all talked about, is interaction or engagement. So I want this panel to also be engaging to all of you. So what kind of questions do you have that either relate specifically to a point that they have made or specifically to one of your concerns as a small business owner or consumer? Then what do you have and what do you want to know from the world of social media and social media marketing and the next wave? Yes, sir.
So is the, I mean, just the thoughts on this, though, like, digital fatigue, like, you were saying, like, Foursquare, things like people draw something, things that sort of pop up, reach critical mass, and then sort of vanish, you know, in a sense. I mean, maybe you can just compare, like, things that have come up and gone away, versus things that sort of have more of a lasting value to people.
Yeah, I think it's hard to be a kingmaker and say that, you know, like, I mean, a year ago I would have told you, like, Pinterest has some staying power, and now I'm probably less sure.
2 years ago was Foursquare that you would
have been. Right, and now, like, Instagram, like, maybe, like, we're not using Instagram too. Right, exactly. Well, so, frankly, Groupon I would have told you from the beginning didn't seem like it had staying power. Right. But certainly, I mean, like, I can give you an example right now, like Snapchat. I don't know if you guys know what this is. Like, this is very, very popular with teenagers. It's gotten a lot of press for being an app that might be misused. Basically, you can send photo, text messages to people that they can only look at for a few seconds, and then they disappear. So it gives you the opportunity to send maybe photos that you wouldn't send ordinarily if you felt like they could be stored and forwarded around. I love this app. I think it's super fun. Part of the reason is because you can, like, once you take the photo, you can draw on it and, like, doodle on it before you send it to your friends. So I was using Snapchat like a crazy person for a while there, and then they came up with this new app called Message Me, which is like a lot like a regular texting app, but I can also do doodles. And now I've like completely abandoned Snapchat, and now I'm doing Message Me. So there is something to be said for like the trends online, and I think like to get like super academic, there's this concept called demand side increasing returns, which like you think about a lot if you study network effects and the way that large networks grow. And what you want as, you know, someone who owns one of these networks is something where people are so ingrained in your platform that they would all need to leave at once for it to go down. And so I think like right now you see, you know, particularly like a Facebook or a Twitter are so tied up in your life. They control all of your contacts. They have all of your photos, you know, whatever it is, they've got a lock on you. For something like Snapchat, it was super easy for me to just walk away and start something new. So I think that's the thing you'd want to look at is like who's got a lock on data and connections and relationships such that you wouldn't want to leave. Because I think those have a little bit more staying power than, you know, just some of these tools that, you know, could be useful but don't really have a...
Yeah, it's actually to add to a follow-up question to that, but we'll go on.
Yeah, so to add to that, I think a really important part is something that Twitter did, which actually bothered me, but they broke up essentially from LinkedIn because they didn't want to just be a vehicle. They didn't want to be something that's sort of a pass-through. They want to have their own independent community. So I do think that's a very concrete example of, no, we need the stakeout, we need that critical mass on our own, standalone.
Cool.
Yeah, so really the issue, but what would give you even more staying power? Content strategy. or he is, make sure, and you don't have to be a journalist to do this, and obviously you all should do it, but just elevate the news above noise. And if they were at Social Media Week, there was an entire panel about this issue, about so the issue with digital fatigue is, as I mentioned, and even with the 99% who will ignore you, who don't care about what you do, they're with the content that figure out so only of what they find on content, only a small fraction would actually be meaningful to them. So at least figure out what is news, what's noise, elevate it. And from my personal experience, what I'm doing is, in fact, currently I'm working with MyCast News. They're a broadcaster from the United Nations. And that's really been the centerpiece with strategy going forward. We're only getting started with digital strategy, so just going forward, the centerpiece is what actually engages people, just the content itself. Worry less about the platform. Worry, even if they have blogs and such, that can still be, you can still go around and blog such if another platform, they offer content that's compelling enough, be it brand, platform, any provider, any publisher, you go with them. So the key would be just elevate the news above the noise.
Any other questions?
Yeah, we talked a lot about the social media. You know, what is your recommendation for the kind of business mediums to improve communication between the employees? I know I talk about chatter, so we use a lot of Office, Microsoft Office Communicator, or YouTube. To increase the communication between the employees. What is your recommendation? Any other?
I think the main recommendation is, and I think one of the keys of this whole entire conversation is, the social element is a double-edged sword. So you actually have to have good corporate culture or in a brand and consumer relationship, a good brand culture that pushes out to the other side. So I think that's a more important message. So as far as ways to communicate, chatter's good, but to be honest, probably 8 out of 10 people that I know, they use it just for the business side, and when the promotion emails come out or the promotion chatters come out, they say whatever, I don't care that much. It's more of the environment itself. So that would be the main focus. Is social is important for things that people care about.
Do any of you use another internal platform for internal chatter?
Yeah, I mean, we use stuff like Asana and Journal Tracker for development pieces.
What is it?
Asana or ASAN. There's a bunch of platforms like that. I know 37 Signals has a few of these.
Basecamp.
They're all similar.
These are project management tools that also have internal communication capabilities, kind of like your in-house Twitter or
It's really whatever you get used to. I mean, that's the biggest thing. When you see a new platform, like, oh, it looks cool, but you have to ramp everybody up. And then if it's too difficult to use, nobody uses it, they go back to email or SMS. I mean, those are always going to be the standbys. It's going back to what you say, corporate culture. If you're a very transparent organization, it might be benefit you in one way. If you're not, it might not. It's going to be a message board, basically.
I'll definitely talk to you about Asana offline.
Actually,
right now.
Another one we use is Trello. So Trello itself, it has a mobile app as well, and it's one of the very few platforms that can work directly on a mobile device. And think of it as a digital whiteboard. That's the closest, at least for me, it's the closest app I found to simulate a whiteboard experience.
That's like a really nice to-do list. Also, it works well for that feature. So I don't work for like a large enterprise. We only have 12 people, so to make a big investment into something like a chatter is like probably too much for us. We're all of our emails hosted through Google Apps, so we do like a lot of GChat, and then my whole development team uses HipChat to do all their kind of like internal.
Well, it's funny that you mentioned that. That was going to kind of bring up Big G right now. It's kind of a final closing question. And internally, we use Google Apps a lot, so our internal communications a lot of kind of old-fashioned instant messaging and kind of GChat, and we're essentially kind of chatting back and forth, let alone all the emails that are getting sent back and forth, and then he's getting more organized. But talking about Big G, when we think about a single company that knows everything about us and can track us everywhere and has all this big data on us, usually there's only one real company that comes to mind to the average consumer. Yet, ironically, to all of what you are saying, that type of company would be phenomenal in the social media and social networking space. What is Google not doing right when it comes to, because I can imagine all of you prefer Google Plus and are all networking through Hangouts, and I've heard so much about that today. So, Any recommendations to Google? And a final thought.
Yeah, and one issue, just one would be contrasting. This is a good case study for contrasting inbound versus outbound marketing. So for those of you not familiar, so inbound would be put out information that people find helpful, draw people in. Whereas outbound would be much of advertising, just you could picture as someone just shouting that you have this promotion, you have this deal with such. So the issue with Google Plus was with Facebook to begin, they never had to advertise, they never had to self-promote, that it was only individual users that invited their friends on, who invited their friends, that's how they grew. Whereas Google Plus, they tried all at once, it was outbound, so not only were others already on platforms, but the issue was they encountered so-called that dance floor issue, that no one will go to a dance if everyone else knows that no one will be there. So that's really the barrier with Google Plus, that you do it all at once, and you don't have any engaged core audience, as Facebook did with Harvard and a few other universities, that Google never had that a core engaged audience on that platform.
Any other thoughts on what Google's?
Our company was privy in a weird way to when Google Plus came out. And actually, we didn't know we were working with Google Plus. I had signed all these NDAs. I was brought in from the agency side, and they wanted to use our NFC technology and incorporate a project. So I signed all these NDAs, and we told them what the company was, and then it went on a standstill for about 6 months. And so having a meeting with the agency, and I'm like, hey, whatever happened to that company? We were doing all that research and all that stuff. They wanted to take a look at. Oh, you know what? It really did well accidentally. It was Google Plus. I can tell you now that it's over. You know, that was the deal. And they didn't actually anticipate that it would actually do well. They thought it was going to bomb, and it was just, all right, it was a test piece. When it actually started getting users, they had to stop because they weren't ready for that. And so now I think it's just the figuring out a lot of like what the next steps are, how to integrate in a lot of pieces. And Google is known to do that. They have two ways they build things. It's either as a silo, and it's like that castle thing. They don't tell anybody about it until it's actually out. Or they build like Gmail. It's bits and pieces, betas, and see how it evolves. And it's a weird culture in that company that they can do the two at the same time. Some work and some don't. But they're very willing to create something and throw it away just to see what the effect
is. As we noticed in the past week. Yeah. So you're saying keep an eye on Google Plus.
Yeah. I use it in the sense that it's tied into the rest of my Google experience, right? But I haven't used a Hangout. I don't really put all my friends or whatever. If it's there and someone says, hey, you're at G+ or whatever, I'll click yes or whatever. But that's about it. Honestly, I don't know the best way to use it. I know Facebook. I know what Twitter does. G+, I don't really have a sense of what it is to this day.
Yeah, and it also is like, where are all your people?
Yeah.
You know, I don't want to have to post to Facebook and post to Twitter and then post to Google+. Yeah. I just want to post in one place, and everybody that I know grew up with Facebook, because Facebook grew into us. So that's sort of why I personally haven't made that migration.
I think also the big focus has to be on content, right? The big reason that a lot of us are on Facebook and Twitter is because that's where all the content is being created and being stored. And Google, for everything that they've done, has not always been the strongest content company. They're really more of a technology company. Like, they provide really useful tools and apps. So I think until they can really nail like the content curation and storage, I think it's going to be tough for them to really draw a lot of eyeballs.
You know, I find the biggest irony is one of my favorite features of Gmail, if any of you use Gmail, is when they suggest other people to be on the email, because I CC tons of people. So they already kind of know what my circles are. They know these 4 or 5 people belong together, these 8 people belong together, there's some overlap. They already know this. Yet, when I go on to Google+, they want me to create my circles manually, when they already have this big data on me. Create the circles for me. And I think that would actually help us engage with Google Circles, because it's creating it for us. They already know about everything about our lives. Why don't they just feed it to us? With that said, if there are no final questions, since we're a little bit over time, I'm sure the panelists will be here for a few minutes to answer any one-on-one private questions, and I'm sure all of them are accessible in one way or another through their favorite social media platforms, if you took notes on it. So on behalf of the panel, I'd like to thank you for your attention and engagement, and I'll look forward to networking with you socially, in person, and then online. Thank you.